sitting here pushing these numbers, my fingers so tired,
fingers so tired.
Calling and calling, you act like you don't hear the ring of my line, no. I'm not trying to bug, I'm not trying to fight, it's alright,
baby, it's alright.
I got a proposal, I want you along for the ride, yeah.
Come on.
I know you upset, I heard your feelings were so bad.
I said, come on.
And every time I call you, forward me to the back.
I say, what's up?
Can't explain what your actions really do to me. Who the fuck wants to be ignored, but I'm patient, you see. Pushing these numbers, my fingers so tight. Calling and calling, you act like you don't hear the ring of my line. No. I'm not trying to bug, I'm not trying to fight, it's alright. I got a proposal, I want you along for the ride, yeah. I know you upset, I heard your feelings are so bad. And every time I call you, follow me to the back. Can't explain what your actions really do to me.
Bruh,
who the fuck wants to be ignored, but I'm patient, you see.
Good evening, good evening, good evening, U Nation Radio. It's your girl, Akilla Trene, and you are tuned in to another episode of Love Sessions. And I am extremely excited because we have a very impactful show for you. We have a lot to do in a little bit of time, but lucky for you, we're here till midnight today. So that is the exciting part. We have an extra 30 minutes. Just as a reminder, so you know, make sure go to Amazon.com, pick up that good Beyond the Hurt, best fictional novel ever that you'll ever read. And because I'm from Oakland, of course, this story is based in Oakland. But yeah, check it out. Amazon.com, Beyond the Hurt by your girl, Akilla Trene. So tonight we have Ice Life in the building. We're talking about the state of black men in America, but he's coming to you soon. We also have an artist spotlight today, and DJ Rhea is going to give you all the information about it. But without any further ado, I'm going to kick it to my left, to my girl, Tanji.
Hi. I'm new to the show. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate this experience. Yesterday I got baptized, so I'm in a peaceful
praise place. Moses.
Yeah.
Yay!
It's my first time ever, so I'm in a very peaceful space.
The water cold.
That's good. You said it's the water cold.
It was kind of warm. It was cool.
Did you?
Where are you going?
Take on any water or anything?
Him and that splash, man.
I don't know. You got baptized at church, right?
Yeah.
Felt like I almost the water drowned. Was warm. I got baptized.
Yeah.
You said you felt like you almost drowned?
Yeah.
No. Oh, I
did. He did.
Oh.
My head, like, he was like.
These are all hell of a story.
I was baptized twice.
Are you a sinner?
No, I just, the first time, it was in like 93 or something.
Two times.
And then I did it again after I was a little older and felt like,
for safety. Understood. Two times for safety, right?
And when's the next one?
You know, I'll do it again.
three times a charm.
We all need a little splash.
Maybe you can do it with your husband today.
Huh?
Maybe you can do it with your husband today.
Yeah, maybe. You want to do that? You want to get baptized?
Yeah. Do it at the wedding. Hey, y'all can start a whole new tradition.
Instead of communion, we'll get baptized.
Born together.
Or we'll just have the preacher sprinkle us.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce myself. Shout out to me. All right. Yeah. It's Charles Handy. You already know who it is. Shout out to all my fantasy leagues I won. Eli Manning, you're on the bench because you made me lose.
Speaking of, shout out to the Oakland Raiders.
I want to represent.
I like that.
Ravens, was it?
Yeah, no, Ravens. But
get it together.
Yeah, by one point.
It was R, though. You was in there.
Yeah, you was right there. But
one of them teams.
It was somebody in the NFL, right? We won. Town Biz. Shout out to Carr. Shout out to Crabtree. You know what I'm saying? It's just a blessed season going on for Oakland, and the Raiders got a lot of good things in store for everybody. But I ain't even trying to hype that up just right now. But
ain't you from Germany?
I represent Germany. You know what I'm saying? I'm international. What can I say? But born in the town, though. Shout out to Oakland. Children's Oakland Hospital. You know what I'm saying? I went to Parker. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to Parker Elementary. You know what I'm saying? Miss Busby.
Giving the whole world.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, Chris. So, hey.
Don't come for my. Don't
save
come
him,
for,
Chris. Don't.
Don't come for the town. Don't come for the town,
Chris.
Let me get off of the mic and pass it to my across the room, because now you're my left. It's all the way across the room to DJ Ree.
Yo, it's your boy DJ Ree. We're here for another night of love sessions on a Monday night here on U Nation Radio. Go ahead and go on Facebook and like us, U Nation Radio. Twitter, U Nation_Radio. Instagram, U Nation Radio. You can also hit us on our website, www.theunationradio.wix.com/MNLS. And the artist spotlight is back tonight. I'm excited about that. So we'll get into that in a minute. But before we get into that, I'm about to kick it over to my man, Dontrell Detroit.
Yo, yo, yo. What's good, fellas? Fam and everybody, I am Dontrell Detroit. Glad to be back in the building. And it's good to be here another day. So back with my people. Another thing set the thing to say. We got an artist spotlight in the building, as you said before. And if you want to join us, you can call in at 323-965-1600. Again, 323-965-1600. We're talking about the state of black men in America and all that encompasses. That could be a plethora of things, and we'll get into that. But since we want to get right into it, I'm going to kick it back to the main man. That is the DJ Ree.
All right, well, let's get into the artist spotlight. I am happy about our spotlight tonight because I know this young lady for about 15 years now. We went to high school together, sang in the choir. She balled with my sister back in high school, and now she a hot artist out the bay from the town, San Francisco.
Yes. What's up with y'all?
I like them better.
I'm so happy to be here. This is tight.
Yes, this is Siani.
It's lit up in here.
Siani.
I'm in the building with my DJ, DJ TNT also, you know.
DJ Boom.
We came straight down here from the Bay. You know.
Really?
That's what's up.
Did y'all drive?
Yeah, we drove.
How long did it take you?
Five hours.
Who was driving?
I was smashing.
Hey. Who was smashing?
You always can tell how fast, if you get there, but once, I don't recommend it, but we got there in like four and a half hours. One time.
It's possible. It's for some reason.
I'm saying half, but it was actually four.
Yeah.
And
if you drive at night and you're smashing.
No, it was daytime. But it was.
Oh, you tripping.
I do not recommend it, but we definitely did like a 4-hour turnaround. And that was insane. Like 100 miles an hour the whole way.
Yeah, no.
We never do that.
In the E-lane? E-lane, because it'd be traffic. Right. I don't know how you
right.
did that.
That's what I'm talking about. You was making up lanes.
I don't know what we was doing, but we got it done.
But yeah, we definitely came down here. We had a show yesterday at the Zen Lounge.
Okay.
Yes, tell us about that.
Definitely. It was at the Zen Lounge. You know, shout out to KD from Track Martians. You know, they throw shows over there a lot. So he had invited me down here. So it was a dope show. The Zen Lounge had me very zenful. I can say that.
They had a little backyard.
Yes. See, we don't have that, you know, option in the Bay because it's too cold.
Right.
So,
exactly.
You know, when you can go out there, you know, chill, do, you know, it was good. It was a nice little venue. I enjoyed myself.
I know you brought a track with you.
We opened up
a one of your tracks called Call Me.
Yes, the first one was Call Me. This one's called Don't Stop. I actually recorded this in a hotel room. I was going through a couple of things and lost my housing, so I was homeless for a little bit. So throughout that, I had done some music, and this is part of a mixtape that I put out called The Dorothy May Project. And it's actually named after my grandmother, because most of the songs and tracks I made were in her house. So I just kind of put the memories into my music, you know what I mean? So this is Don't Stop. This is Love Session, so it's a nasty song, just saying. So, you know, fellas, you can put this on for your ladies, you can put this on for your man, whatever you want to do.
What are they not stopping exactly?
You know, whatever you do in the bedroom that's good, that you good at, don't stop doing that. Because if you stop doing that, then you're going to have a problem. Because your mate is going to be like, what happened? Because that was good. So you better not stop. You better don't.
Let's get into the
you
track.
You better don't.
Let's get into the track.
Don't stop, 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 don't just ask me for it. I can give you what you need, don't have to pay for it. I can spot it, all the things that you wanna do. I can guarantee to give it right in front of you. I
guarantee to make your body always go down. Ever since I came up, yeah, you always been around. Every night I see you, every night I feel you. Every night I wanna come closer to you. Every night I wanna talk on the phone. Every night I wanna stay home all alone. You tell me your feelings, I keep you your secrets. You can give it all to me, don't stop while we're freaking.
Don't stop, don't stop, don't stop it.
JTNT, where everything's exclusive. Play that shit.
That's Iyanny.
Yay.
But don't stop.
Ooh. Yay.
Don't stop till you get enough.
Don't stop till you get enough. Hey.
Who produced that joint?
That was produced by a friend of mine named Boog. He actually made that beat at my house, at my granny's house. So, you know, I do producing too here and there. I was just making some beats before we left to come over here. But I definitely do some producing. I definitely do songwriting. And, you know, it's a lot that I do actually. Party hosting, radio hosts. We have our own radio show and everything in the Bay at bayliferadio.com. So, yeah, it's a lot.
You got it all going on.
Yeah, you know, we out here trying to get it, you know. It's a lot going on out here, so it's something to keep me occupied from all the other crap that's going on in the world right now. So it's definitely, you know, helpful.
You rock with Hyro?
I definitely do love Hyro. I got a dope era shirt on right now, though. Shout out to Mr. Fab. Definitely shout out to Mr. Fab. This is his clothing line called Dope Era.
Shout out to FAB.
Yeah, so he has a little collaboration going on with Hyro, so this is definitely like their little collab together.
Yeah, I gotta get one of those.
Yep, go to the Mr. Fab store.
Yeah. All right, I'm gonna do it online, but I still like free stuff though.
You know right, you gotta get him in here.
Day. Hey, throw your boy a shirt, man. What's good?
Definitely.
So tell the people where they can get the mixtape and how they can reach you.
You can definitely get the mixtape at DatPiff, also on Coast to Coast Mixtapes.
Audio Mac.
That's right, Audio Mac. Also, you can catch a couple of tracks on SoundCloud. It's soundcloud.com/Ciani. It's spelled C-E-I-O-N-E. And you can find me on Instagram at Ciani, C-E-I-O-N-E. Facebook, Ciani Hill. YouTube, Ciani 87. What else do I have? SoundCloud, Twitter at DVFCEO.
Snapchat
at the Flocker.
Periscope?
No, I don't have Periscope. See, I don't have all that.
I was with you. I'm like,
I personally think Periscope fell off.
It fell off.
Facebook Live is like just throwing a whole glitch in Periscope's matrix.
Definitely. I don't even know any of this other stuff that's out anymore. That's all I got. That's about it. That's where you can find me basically on all those social medias.
In your show.
Oh, definitely. Tune in to bayliferadio.com. We have a radio show called The Cut. Me and my DJ, DJ TNT, who's sitting next to me.
Right.
It's an indie hip-hop and R&B show, so it's not only Bay music, so it's music all around because a lot of music gets slept on because it's a lot of crap out there that people are playing and doing now. So we're trying to get the new, you know, underground hip-hop music, the real music going out, people that don't get heard so much because... as an artist myself, I know how it feels to not be able to be heard, and you're just everybody's distracted and kind of blindsided and looking in one direction. So we trying to cut that and get everybody out there. We do radio interviews with artists and everything like that. So it's pretty cool. BayLifeRadio.com, The Cut, every Thursday from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m.
Wednesday and Thursday.
Oh, yeah, Wednesday and Thursday.
Y'all get it in.
Right.
And shout out to y'all. I think it's dope. Just like a couple weeks, I just want to say this, but Glasses was talking about how new artists, you got to, you know, work with your DJ. If you say you want to get on and y'all got a show together, I think that's dope as y'all coming together as a package, because I think any artist that's on up and coming, You gotta be able to work with your DJ and understand, like, y'all are the show. Yeah. Y'all, that's your band. And Glasses just kind of broke it down. Shout out to him. And I just see it. Like, a lot of people don't understand that as an artist and how important it is to the show.
It's super, super important. Mind you, we just kind of started. We just connected probably, like, 6 months ago?
Yep, just about.
I was hosting a party that he was DJing at, and some stuff kind of fell off, and we just kind of connected after that. Maybe it was God, you know? So we kind of connected after
know what
that.
It was? She kept telling me, you're going to host my mixtape, and I kept asking her, like, when you ready?
Right, that too.
Come on.
That too. So
made it happen.
But I've been doing music for probably like 7 years now as an independent artist, and I think I definitely have found the key to this whole independent artist stuff. You definitely need a DJ. It's so much easier, definitely easier, and it's an easier way to access to networking too. I've met so many people because of him, like a lot of people that I've never thought I'd be like interacting with, you know what I mean? Because he DJed so many places, like he's DJed everywhere.
No DJ, no party.
No DJ, no party. Straight like that, you know. So like,
straight up,
a DJ is definitely something that you definitely need as an artist, because then
I got a pretty good Spotify playlist, though. You know what I'm saying?
Can't compete with me. On
the hey, he can host your Spotify playlist. let him get on there and drop some bombs on the Spotify playlist hosted by DJ TNT.
Right.
Definitely. Yeah. But yeah, it's very important to have a DJ. Definitely have people that back you up, because it's hard doing it by myself, and I've done it for so long by myself, and now I don't have to anymore, and it's awesome. Because it's more than just me promoting my music. It's him, and he's right. More places than I am. So he contacts more people and sees more fans and interacts with more people than I do. So he's like the key to the whole, like, the whole spectrum besides me doing my music and making sure it's awesome, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it helps with shows too. Like, you know, you just don't have a simple playlist. You have a DJ back there scratching for you. You interacting with your DJ. He got a mic, you got a mic. Like old school, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's dope. I love it. It's awesome.
Yeah. That's what's up.
Yeah.
I want to thank you guys for coming in.
Definitely. I'm glad y'all, you know, brought us in here, man. We want to come back.
Oh, hey. Definitely.
Yeah, hey, yeah. Keep it going.
We got something new coming.
For sure.
Definitely. I definitely have an album coming out. I'm in the works of doing that, so we're gonna see. I be down here a lot, so I'm going to have to come visit y'all.
Well, you know where to find us.
Definitely.
And hopefully you guys can stay as we transition into the conversation that we're going to have about the state of black men in America.
Oh, yeah, I got something to say,
who
too.
Knows which and where and all that that we're going to go, but we're absolutely going wherever we can.
Definitely.
But with that said, I'm going to get into the intro of our guest that we have, Mr. Ice Life. I'm excited about this one because, of course, Ice Life has been with us before in the studio. And, of course, he's from Oakland and went to high school with me and Charles. And so it's always, you know, a good feeling to have, you know, people that you've known and grown up with in the building. So, Ice Life. If you don't know, HBO, Deaf Poetry, Huffington Post, New York Times. Ice Life is an award-winning recording artist, justice advocate, author, and actor. Additionally, he's one of the leading spoken word artists in America with a broad fan base stemming from his appearances on several commercial market platforms and his social and political commentary, which exists in the realms of published works, major network guest commentary, college speaking, and even conceptual art. He is the executive director of Ice Life Productives, a highly retained California-based product development firm with a client portfolio that includes Kaiser Permanente, the National Fair Housing Alliance, University of California Regents, Comedy Central, and Deloitte. And sorry if I said it wrong. For his latest conceptual art project, Brighter Than Blight, Life transformed a blighted, condemned housing project into a life-size exhibition and artistic narrative on housing as a human right. From its onset, the project was ambitious and massive, but at completion was hailed as not only unprecedented, but also as a stellar success. Brighter Than Blight was covered by major media outlets throughout the U.S. and attracted a broad audience, as well as hired and trained dozens of young people and community members. His fame, hip-hop theater production, Pistols and Prayers, based on the book of the same title, premiered at the Tony Award-winning Berklee Repertory Theater and brings together on one stage spoken word, American folk spirituals, classic music, hip-hop, and theater to address American apathy and resilience through the lens of the generation born into the 1980s, 1990s crack epidemic. A powerful collage of thought-provoking socio-political commentary blended with a glimpse into the author's coming of age as a man, artist, and advocate for social change. This young man has a decade of experience in performance and education that includes residencies and lectures at over 300 universities, including, y'all hear me, Yale and Princeton. Ice Life's hometown of Oakland, you know about it, Detroit, awarded him with one of his highest honors by dedicating his birthday, December 28th, as Ice Life Day in the city of Oakland. Without any further ado, U Nation Radio family, Love Sessions, please help me welcome to the show, back to the show, Ice Life.
Hey, y'all. I'm sorry you had to suffer through all of that.
Let them know what it is.
When you're accomplished, you're accomplished. I mean, hey, that's what it is.
I appreciate it.
What's up, y'all? I appreciate you being back. So you just got off a plane. What were you doing? Where were you?
I was home in Oakland.
Okay.
It had been a little bit, and I was home for maybe 4 or 5 days, and it was cool. Oakland is changing.
Okay.
Tell
me a little bit about that, because that's I have a friend who that her posts basically are like that all the time. Like every time she goes to like a cafe or a restaurant, she's like trying to figure out, is this still Oakland? Like what's going on? And I felt like it's maybe the good, the blessing and the curse at the same time, in a sense.
Well, across the country, what's happening in Oakland is happening across the country in major cities.
Merck Park.
You know, we call it, it gets called like gentrification.
Right.
But gentrification is the resurgence of white power in America. And not, by white power, I don't mean like, you know, the Klan on horseback.
Right.
But what I do mean is a resurgence of the families who 2 generations ago had the power and the presence in Baltimore and South LA, in West Oakland, coming back and taking back the power in the land, the houses, and the platforms that control the city. So that's happening in Oakland, but there's still a lot of vibrancy and a lot of beauty in Oakland. And so my purpose in being back home is always to try to stay in the mix and stay in the fight, you know. And so it was good to be there. And I love being here in Los Angeles.
Which one do you like better?
It's hard to say. I love Oakland, you know, more than I love L.A. It's not a diss to L.A., but I enjoy being here.
What is that sound?
I can't hear the sound. I don't have the head. But what was the sound? It was crickets. It was crickets. Then was L.A. roaches. Then wasn't crickets.
Don't them. You don't want to put on the...
I'll put on a headset.
I mean,
I know you got the nice look going. You know what I'm saying? Shout out, you know, y'all cool now.
I just want to know who's left in Oakland. If everybody's here,
I told you.
Who's left in Oakland?
Marshawn Lynch.
That's about it.
Marshawn Lynch
is a swap.
It's a swap.
It's a lot of LA cats up in the Bay.
Right.
You know, what happens in Oakland is those of us who come up in Oakland, you know, Oakland is a beautiful city. Also, is a hard city. Yeah. To come up in, you know, like you graduate from Oakland Unified School District, you survive Oakland.
I say that with confidence, like, yo, yeah. Hey, you make it out of there with a degree, especially, yo, you doing something.
So
you might be going places.
A lot of folks in Oakland, you know, we sit around and, you know, you have an ambition and it sends you away from there. But we also in California, it's the best state to live in if you're going to live in America. And I think a lot of us just come down to L.A. and find each other there and connect with good folks in L.A.
Y'all beautiful people, you know. I just want to know. I mean, because it's like every time I see a phone number, it's 510. Just 5. I'll be like,
keep that 510.
You gotta give a cat to tell you he from Oakland or she from Oakland the Oakland test though, because what happens is people who are from Stockton and Antioch and Palo Alto and Hayward,
my cousin and them from Oakland.
Yeah, but they go, I'm from Oakland, and they're not from Oakland.
Right.
Even now, I see cats in Oakland that's not from Oakland. They say they're from Oakland. It's good to see you. She bona fide. She's the real deal.
The epitome, huh? That's what's up. Well, we back here talking about the state of black men of America. Not Oakland, but...
That's in America. Well, Oakland is in America.
Them too. Yeah, but that's so central. Like, and I feel overwhelmed by Oakland at the moment. But no, I'm just playing. So right now, just give us a general statement of where you feel black men are, in whatever facet you want to start at.
Mm-hmm. I can't be a representative for all of us, but I'm steeped in the work that's around us and our state as a people. When you talk about the state of black folks in America, I think one thing that's really important to look at in that phrase is America.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my grandpa used to say if white folks got a cold, black folks got the flu. You know what I'm saying? Or black folks have pneumonia. So if, like, you think about, like, America, the Great Depression was the great psychosis for us, you know? And so a lot of the ills that we see black men struggling with are ills that the country has. And we have that to a more extreme degree because of the social structure here. At the same time, I think when you look at, I don't care if it's the most broke down, hanging on a string of life brother on the side of a freeway, all the way to a upwardly mobile, creative, vibrant, healthy brother you see, both of them are miracles in the context of this country if we're alive and we're there and present. So I think we exist in a very beautiful way. I think we exist in a triumphant way. I also think that being a black man in America is an art. It's really a art form to move and finesse here and be well here. So that would be that's my short answer.
Something we talked about was the fact of where you feel like we don't have necessarily enough of our the OGs that are just like really doing really well, that we can, as young black men or young black professionals, it's something that's lacking, where we might not necessarily just have like a good 45-year-old businessman that could just mentor you. Some of those are lacking, as far as not, let alone just having fathers around, but just also, could you talk about that conversation as far as just having like straight up OGs that can guide you as a young black professional?
It's important that we understand the authors of our oppression, because like so right now, if the lights go off in here and everybody wake up with a broken jaw when the lights come back on, and you have no explanation, one is you riddled with fear. You start blaming the people next to you. We was the only ones in here, you know, and on top of that, you feel depressed, you know. After a while, when can't nobody explain it, it's like, damn, was I destined to have a broken jaw, you know? Until somebody can play a surveillance tape back and see that when the lights went off, some other people came in here and knocked us in our jaw. And not only does that empower you and take the depression off of you, it teaches you and makes you feel, a righteous, healthy anger about why your jaw is broken. So when we talk about black folks and our struggle in this country, we always talk about two things. We talk about slavery, and we talk about civil rights. But for our generation in particular, to what you're talking about, Charles, we never talk about the crack epidemic in this country. And other than the transatlantic slave trade, the most devastating thing that ever happened to black people was the crack epidemic.
Yeah.
The crack epidemic creates that. When you talk about 45 years old, who's 45 right now? Who's 50 and 60 right now? Those are folks that were born in the 60s and 70s, who in the 80s were devastated by the crack epidemic.
Yeah.
And then all the way through the 90s, through mass incarceration of brothers and sisters and people being hooked on drugs and being born addicted to drugs, and how our families are devastated in that way, that removes black men and women. But to a deeper level, we see black men missing in that age group in our communities. And so what we lack, like we here in Hollywood.
Yeah.
When I'm over at ABC, I also want to say that everything I'm saying, I exist here in a real way, in networks, on major media platforms, at universities. I never don't talk like this.
Yeah.
I want to encourage us to don't feel like you have to trade in your success or your access to have these conversations.
Right.
When I walk in ABC, when I walk in major networks, the men, if we're talking about the men, white men have a multi-generational thing going on. It's an old cat in there. It's a young old cat in there, in his 60s, all the way to a 17-year-old intern. Mm-hmm. And they all have each other. So when the 17-year-old intern is about to do something dumb, it's a 45-year-old white cat to go, hey, nah, don't do that. But with us, what's going on with brothers is we are bastardized. So when you fail, if you're 25 and you act outside of your marriage, or you're 25 and you make a bad decision in business, or you're 25 and you pick up an addiction, whatever, you fall all the way back to zero because there's no conversation or anybody for you to rely on. And that's just how it impacts brothers. I think it also impacts sisters in the same way. So, I think it's really important that we be really deliberate about rebuilding that bridge with us around having intergenerational conversations.
I think we're getting to, we're about to be those dudes in a second.
Speak for yourself, brother.
Right.
I'm joking, bro.
Hey,
when you say low key, you lose an Oakland star.
Yeah, no, prayfully I would be the guy, and I have been in situations of young brothers that's coming up, because fools that's like 5 years older than me, because I'm married and got kids, they be like Uncle Chuck. I be like, damn, you know what I'm saying? I'm like an old dude now. But at the same time, I will try to share what any kind of keys to success I get my hands on. Like, I'm gonna try to share them. Because, I'm going to quote Maya Angelou, but she says, at our best, we're all teachers. You know what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, if I got a key that can help you, why not give it to you as a young black brother or black sister that's coming up? Because this game that we're both a part of, it's like we're behind the eight ball in a lot of different ways. And like you say, we only get so many chances. We only get so many shots. We can't be, I believe, in my experience, you can't be, what's his name, Iron Man? Look at Iron Man. What's his name? Who's Iron Man right now?
Robert
Downey Jr. Robert Downey Jr. fell so many times. He's been locked up several, different things happened in his life. But at the end of the day, what happened was he was able to get picked back up on his own two and shine bright. You know what I'm saying? And really get over his addictions. And that's a prime example of if a young brother was getting arrested constantly and doing those same type of things, I don't think that he would get that same shot to be like on the next top tier blockbuster, situation. You know what I'm saying? And that's just the honest truth. There's not enough opportunities out there to just be like messing up continuously. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I want to say first, as a black woman, that I do appreciate the black man, but it took me a while to even get to that point because I had a stage in my life where I was just on the fence. Like, I'm mad at black men, and I'm happy with black men, and I'm mad again, and now I'm happy again.
That's life.
And so I had to realize that it comes with a lot of healing. And as he was saying earlier, the crack epidemic, you know, we're the children and we're the, like, everything toppled on top of us. So the mass incarceration, everything, the deaths, everything has fallen on us. And then we're here and we're just left as, like, what do we do next, you know? So as a Black woman, if we're trying to struggle and we're trying to figure out what to do next and we're trying to have the backs of Black men, but we have failed in our own healing, then it's kind of like, where do we go? Where do we start from there?
Can I share a story with y'all?
Yes, please.
I appreciate what you're saying, and the story speaks to what you're talking about. I was doing my own research investment around immigrant families here in America.
Mm-hmm.
And I spent time with three Vietnamese families. And one thing I noticed at the first house is that all of the older people, when they were closing cabinets or closing a door, they were doing it real gently. And it looked odd, almost like they'd be moving regular pace. And when they go to close something, they close it really slow. And when I saw it at the second house, finally I leaned in on the person that was helping me audit the class. And I asked him, he was Vietnamese. I said, why do they do that? Why do they, the older people? And he said, oh, well, they were in Vietnam during the war. So a loud boom or a clamp will have them tripping because they was around the explosions, mm-hmm. and the loud noises. So their relationships and their space around each other is informed by the war that they went through.
Mm-hmm.
And when you sitting at Applebee's and a brother walk up on you and go, hey, you know, how you doing, you know, and start that conversation, we don't start building that relationship in the context of the war that we in. Or the war that we've been through. So when a brother get mad and he just walk out, you know what I'm saying? Even when a cat walk down, the most disgusting thing I see brothers doing a lot is, I'll give you two examples of each gender. When brothers yell foul stuff out a car at a woman, brother is absent of what it's like to be a sister walking down the street.
Yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I heard two sisters having a conversation on the train once. And the girl was talking about how she went out with this dude, she liked him, and she looked him up online, and he had a criminal record. And she was like, so girl, I was like, uh-uh. Mm-hmm. She don't understand the plight of brothers.
Mm-hmm.
If she go and look up his criminal record and stop doing it. Now, I agree with that. I agree with that. Now, if she went,
wait,
she said, what'd he do? Now, if she found him,
he down there for murder one, rape two, child molestation.
If she found him on a sex offending site, that's a different scenario.
Yeah.
But, you know, sisters will Google you and find out, you know, you've been to jail. You know, a lot of brothers been to jail. Yeah. What if brother could look up your abortion record?
And had a judgment
placed on that. So what I'm saying is our relationships and how even non-intimate relationships. If I own a company, I hire brothers. If I hire a brother and, you know, his professionalism is kind of lacking something, you know, I'm not going to fire a brother based on a typical standard. I understand the plight that we deal with. You know what I'm saying? If sister come in the office and sit down and she seem a little out of the ordinary, or she short-tempered, you know, I understand that. I understand what she – or I want to try to understand that. So I think it's really important that when we look at other ethnic groups that thrive, part of the reason they thrive is they understand and never live outside of the reality of what it is that they've been through as a people. And I think that's important.
Could I jump in for
you,
the
boss,
bro? I'm just one of God's children.
What am I saying? No.
Right. No, you can't speak.
That's the way of saying yeah. Right. Why don't you speak it?
Yeah. Hey, you know what? Shout out to you, Ice Man, because you it just like listen to you speak and just remembering all the different poems that you did during high school and assemblies and just I'm bringing it back, but it's like it's a trip just to see the effect that you had, and you've been at it for a long time and doing it for a lot of years.
Thank you.
And
man.
It's like you was real dope in high school, and it was moving. Like people would be like, I remember one poem that you had, and it was a girl on the stage that was like acting out the whole, you know what I'm saying, poem. I don't even know what it was, but it was dope. You know what I'm saying? Remember what I'm talking about? Yeah, and it was just like, and everybody in the room was really affected by it. And I just think that that you've been impacting people as far as your words and all that for a long time. And
thank you,
you know, to bring it all the way back, I would say when something that you did even just today coming in was Charlamagne says this, but it's like be the energy that you want to bring, that energy into the room that you want to be. So, for example, when you came in today, you're like, hey, peace, you know, how you doing? You know, shaking everybody's hand. And that's something that's important that I definitely know as black men, that there's something there. You know what I'm saying? I grew up, my background is I was born in Oakland, but then I moved to Germany and then when I was six, coming back and forth, and then all my life. And then when I was 16, I came back to live in Oakland, graduated from Skyline. But all that to say is that growing up overseas, basically, is like, I didn't grow up. I feel like as black men, we kind of have when we initially see each other, there's something there. There's something there that is unsaid, it's unspoken, but there, it's like a little stare, and it's a moment that if you don't do the head nod, it's like somebody that's trying to feed your energy. And for me personally, one of my tools of bringing in energy too, I'm like an energy person. So I'm like, I'll smile at you. I'll give you the head nod. I'll say hi. But if I don't give you that and you're in a certain space and a certain mentality, you're going to be like, I don't like that dude. And it's something, but the reality is it's really nothing. Mm-hmm. The true reality is nothing happened. You could be thinking about whatever you're thinking about. I could be thinking about whatever I'm thinking about, and I just came in. Mm-hmm. That's the reality. But in the moment, we could be like, oh, what's this dude trying to do? You gonna disrespect me? You just gonna come in here and not speak? Oh, what am I, you know? And then it becomes this thing that perpetuates into something more. And I just wonder, like, if a lot of dudes really understood just how we need to love each other. Going back to love sessions, love each other, respect each other, and also just acknowledge our own selves, you know what I'm saying, in different situations, you know what I'm saying. And I think that would kill a lot of tension that we have between each other, you know.
I agree, brother.
Well, we're sitting here talking about the state of black men in America. We've come very far, but have we come far enough? We've done a lot. Have we done enough? This is Cisco Drew Hill. Is it enough whenever we get in with
Chris? This is Cisco Drew Hill?
I was trying to read what he got over there, and I forgot which one it was. And he got more than one pulled up, okay. You know. But anyway.
Going to Cisco? Oh, man.
Constantly, but I know you don't believe
All right. So we are back on Love Sessions. Again, it's your girl, Akilah Trene. And we are talking about the state of black men in America. And we have Mr. Ice Life in the building joining the conversation, keeping it very intellectual and positive and everything that we need. No, don't be sorry. That's perfect. But what I did want to ask is, okay, just growing up, and it doesn't necessarily have to be an Oakland thing, but that's where you grew up. So, but just growing up in a place, right, a neighborhood, considering all of the circumstances and public schooling and all of that, I know there was a different side, you know, to Ice Life growing up. And I just want you to kind of speak to, especially for our younger male listeners, just kind of that process from kind of being the knucklehead, you know, young boy to more of the, you know, conscious, just more understanding of, you know, who you were at a young man to become.
I think that for me coming up, my life was a bit of a perfect storm that I'm really grateful for. Just different things in my childhood that planted seeds deep, deep in my chest when it was time for me to be ready for them to bloom. You know, that was there. I've talked about many times about an experience that I had at a Hot Boy concert that changed my life. Seeing somebody lose their life at a concert and not changing because it scared me, but changing because I saw it and I didn't feel nothing. You know, and that startled me.
I remember that concert.
Was that the one at the Coliseum?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
that was on the news. It was crazy.
Yeah. I remember my boy got jumped at that concert. Yeah, it was crazy
ride. And so, but for me, you know, I was in a bank maybe a year ago now, and when I was leaving, the little brother that was a teller, he came, you know, running out. He said, "Excuse me, sir." Sorry, that's new, you know, people calling you sir, you know. And he said, "Man, and how do, little brother, you know, probably like 22 or something, you know, man, how do I be successful?" And, you know, he just kind of, and I said something kind of generic to him, you know, and I realized what it was. His brother saw me park my car, you know, and then when he was coming in from his lunch break, and then he was my teller, so he had some access to my business.
Right.
And then when I was leaving, he stopped. Come on, Shaw.
I'm trying to, you know, just, you know, interpret what you said.
But I thought about it, you know, because I wasn't prepared to answer him then, but I think it's five things that's key for any little brother to try to be successful. The first thing is to take yourself seriously. That don't mean be serious, but take yourself seriously. You know, the second thing I think is to be open to doing and trying new things, going outside of your comfort zone in everything, from places you travel to. When somebody tells you, "Hey, let's go to Disneyland," or "Hey, let's go to Vegas," that's a no if you've done it already. You know, you'd be surprised, even without leaving your city, where you can go that's totally different. It'll open your mind. Mm-hmm. Look up the free day at the museum for you to go to the museum. You know what I'm saying? When you're taking a girl out, have something different than the movies.
Yeah,
you know, I don't care if you're 16. You know, like, really be thinking about that. The third thing is, I think it's really important to pursue a socio-political education. I don't care if you went to business and to being a fireman, whatever it is you want to do. Understand the history of our people and the current state of our people. That's really important. The fourth thing I think that's really important is to be mindful about what you eat and what you put in your body.
Like, no really pork on your fork.
Really, whatever it is, whatever you find in your process. Because, you know, one thing I'm grateful for in the storm, like now, like, you know, I have a diet that people would expect me to have as far as what I eat and don't eat. You know, but, you know, when cats was around me and I was eating a number three with cheese and a Coke, you know, and a, you know, and all of that, I was never judged for it, but I was exposed to different ways of eating.
Right.
And the last thing, and it's kind of crass, but treat your penis like porcelain.
Mm. It's the truth.
How do you treat porcelain?
Very gently and carefully. and you be concerned with where you put it at and where you move it. And I'm not just talking about, I mean, it's real, like STDs and STIs and all of that. But also that, you know, if you're not ready and you have a child, that knock a lot of wind out of your sails if you're going to be in one or two ways. Either you're going to be 20, 22, or if you're not ready and you're 30, you're going to have, if you're a good cat, you're going to be present when you're not ready to be still. Or you're going to run, and that's going to put a whole lot of other turmoil in your life. You know, because life is very abstract. You don't know what your purpose is, but children are just definite. Right. That's out of your body, you. So that's your child. And I think that's really important. And another thing that I had to learn later, if I was to speak to brothers in their mid-20s and through your early 30s, really scrutinize yourself around your actions with women. A sister said something to me that really blew my mind. And I always give her a hard time because, you know, she's a real, you know, she shaved butter, head wrapped. You know, the intersectionality of the right. You know, she's one of them. And she was like, Ice, I told my man when he was cheating on me, it was a form of sexual assault. And I started to write it off. Like, I don't know, maybe. She said, no, Ice. He was making decisions about my body. Without my consent.
Yeah.
It's a form of assault. And when she said that to me, it hit me.
Yeah.
And
especially
and good brothers.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about cats like me, I'm macking you. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about young cats. I'm not telling you don't be with women. I'm not telling you to do whatever you want to do. But I am saying
there's levels and use protection.
But I'm also saying, Charles, I'm saying
it's a way to do it.
Be honest and be forthright. And that's something that we all struggle with. And those things will hinder your flow. You know, so that's my short answer. Forgive me for talking long, but I think that those are the things that I advise around. And those are the things that brought me to a point that I'm really grateful for in my life.
I'm glad you spoke about honesty. And we're talking about the state of black men. So if you're going to call in, please call us at 323-965-1600. I was having a conversation with a young lady yesterday, and we were talking about the state of black men or men, period. But I was talking about black men with the lack of ability to tell the truth. And, you know, if anybody knows me, like, I don't let women off the hook for anything. You know, like, you are as accountable as I am, and I don't care that you are a woman. But when we got to this point, like, to me, there was no getting around this. You know, I had the phase where you didn't think you could tell the truth to a woman. And now I try to tell a lot of people younger than me, like, just tell her the truth. And then I was telling them the story. I said, and it's kind of crazy because now that I think back, there was never a situation where I told the truth to a woman. And not only did it not get me in trouble, that it didn't go my way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it might have been, maybe it was something appear for her to get acclimated to. Okay, all right, you're different, but okay, cool. You know, maybe something that you don't. But at the end of the day, it was like, all right, they came around to it, or whatever it was that I thought was I was apprehensive about saying, and then it was okay. And so many times today, like the stupidity that we end up in with women is just behind not telling the truth, and they're so encompassing. They deal with so much on a daily basis, like. Your truth is actually a reprieve to them. And so...
So why do people lie?
my theory is out of love.
No, but... Well, I'm not... I won't say no like I'm all
going.
Bam!
That is... No,
maybe one of the reasons.
Anybody say they lying because they love you, that's not true.
No, I'm just saying the thought about it is backwards. Most people, when people don't care or give a F about you, they'll tell you the blatant truth, like trying to hurt you. And then people that love you, trying not to hurt you, lie.
Well, we lie. I want to talk about black men lying, but also just in general, people lying. People lie when they're not comfortable with their truth.
True.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, like, for me in my life, I had to really go, man, is it that I'm not comfortable with myself? And so I'm not comfortable discussing it to somebody else. But remember, when it comes to relationships, like I've done work in the pen with women, and you tell a woman stop the violence. Mm-hmm. She might be in there, you know, her brother was out of prison doing well. He had 2 strikes. Somebody called the police on him for something he didn't do. Now he doing life in prison. But stop the violence. Sometimes when we tell people stop the violence, we mean I know he shot your mama. But stop the violence. That's a deep thing to ask somebody. Mm-hmm. Understand, it's important, again, acknowledging the war. Brothers get punked all day. All day. Whether it's we can't get hired, the police pull me over, I feel like I wasn't valuable because I don't have no money. I look in the mirror, I feel ugly. I feel all of that. And the one thing, the one little lift up, the one compliment, the one interest people have in you is your sexual conquest. Mm-hmm. Your ability to have sex with multiple women.
Beautiful.
When that brother say, when the girl's walking down the street and she hella polite, and you know, no, but no thank you, but I'm seeing somebody, he like, well, F you then B, that ain't about you.
Right.
That's something mm-hmm. deep in him yeah. that's right. wounded.
Right.
And so brothers seek validity. So when you say, just don't sleep with nobody else, or just tell me the truth, that's deeper than a surface really? Ask. But mm-hmm. it's brothers' responsibility to be bigger than the pain and to not assume that it's on people to just absorb whatever your issue is. But that's something that we struggle with. But when I be reading articles, you know, the top 10 reasons men lie, or like men are dogs and da-da-da, all of that is outside of an understanding of the war on us, man.
I would also add to that lying aspect is sometimes I believe that, you know, say for instance, you know, 2 consenting adults are sleeping together, you know what I'm saying? And the thing is that the guy, eventually, for the most part, the girl is probably going to eventually catch feelings. She gonna inquire, hey, what are we? What's going on here? And the guy, you know, a lot of guys, they want their cake and eat it too. So they don't want that. They don't want to stop having access to what's going on. So eventually he's going to have to possibly go down a road that he probably wasn't ready to go down, which is a relationship. The relationship now is, they got this thing on Twitter, it's like a situationship, right? And so that's like you're convenient to me because we're having sex with each other. I'm enjoying having sex with you. You're leveraging stop having sex with me unless I'm committed to a relationship with you. So you get into a relationship based off of something that really isn't what you want to base a relationship off of, which is sex, kind of. And then at the same time, you're mad at the dude might just do his own thing on the side. But in his mind, he was probably already planning on doing his thing, but he had to kind of call a little audible to make sure, you know what I'm saying, to make sure that he kept his situation going on. I mean, I don't know. I think that's...
My response is a whole nother show, so I'm just going to leave it alone.
Nah, okay. All right.
I don't disagree with you. I just have something to add, but it's a whole nother show.
I might have an answer to that. This is what I call my half and half. Just for the simple fact that I have the mentality of a man and a woman. I'm going to just say it like that. I feel like when a man lies, women lie too. So that's the one thing you gotta remember too.
Men lie, women lie.
You gotta remember that even though you think you know you're lying to her, she could be holding the same thing back from you. So communication is always a key. It doesn't even matter because I feel like it gives you an option to decide what you want to do. You know what I mean? So just like Kiara, you were saying, you don't want to, you know, I don't want to stop messing with you, but I just want to tell you how it is. It's always better to keep it 100, like we say in the Bay, always keep it 100. Because keeping it 100 always you don't have conflict. You don't have this lady judging you because she's going to figure it out sooner or later. You know, lies come around all the time. You know what I mean? She's going to figure it out sooner or later. But I feel like as the aspect of the whole thing, I feel like communication is the key to everything.
There's also dual scheming going on.
Yeah. Always.
See, this is the thing.
Ulterior motive.
There's always dual scheming going on. So, for example, a guy, let's say you hanging out with a woman, and she says, you know, Charles, I really like you. Your name is in.
I'm married, by the way. Shout out to my wife.
You know, Charles, you know, I really like you. You know, I think you're great, but I'm not really trying to sleep with you. Charles and go, sleep with you. You kind of stuck up. I would sleep. Are we just hanging out? No, I'm cool with that. But soon as they get alone, Charles reaching for her butt.
Yeah.
Now, shout out to my wife.
Right.
But this is now, a hypothetical. It's totally hypothetical. On the flip, though, a woman be hanging out with a guy. She like him. And the dude says, you know, Sharifa, I really like you. You know, I really think you're great. You know, and all of that. But you know, I'm not really looking for a relationship. And Sharifa go, relationship? Who's talking about that? But as soon as y'all get along, you reaching for the relationship butt.
Mm-hmm.
So there's
a relationship butt.
Yeah, relationship butt.
Yeah.
But because so there's a that's an interesting thing. But it's all scheming. And but again, definitely, when y'all talking about black folks. Sister might need you for something deeper than what it seemed like it's about.
Mm-hmm.
And brothers wanting you, your validation of getting in bed with him might be deeper than just that. And I think that's important for us to acknowledge. We out our mind trying to be in relationships and mimic what we see on TV or in a movie. Our condition and it don't, no matter what your sexual orientation is, if you LGBTQ, whatever your if you a black person trying to deal with a black person in any kind of relationship, all the way down to a person robbing you. If you black and the person robbing you is black, that's a different relationship.
Mm-hmm.
If you black and the person you going into business, it's just entirely different. And I feel like a issue with us is that we move forward in relationships without being considerate of that. You know, this weekend I went back home, like I said, and I had a beautiful time hanging out with the brothers. I grew up on a dead end street in Brookfield, and we all met up. We ain't all been together in over 10 years,
mm-hmm.
more than that. And we all went and kicked it in San Francisco. We got on the train, we went to the city. We had a beautiful time. My little homie DJ, he gave me a ride. And he said, I'm going to drop you off, but before I drop you off, I got to pick up my son. And, you know, he ride down High Street, go and pick up his baby. And I'm not really tripping, you know. And his son comes, gets in the backseat. I go, hey, what's up, man? I'm an old friend of your dad, and he goes, sup? And you know, he putting on his little car seat things, not the full car. And I said, how old are you, man? And I think he said he's 7. And I'm looking at that brother. I met his daddy when his daddy was his age.
Mm-hmm.
That's significant for us. That's really significant and beautiful for us. So I think it's important that we see ourselves in that context.
I agree. I have a question.
Yeah.
Well, I want to say that there's two things that I notice about the black culture. Is that one, we're all about survival. Like, we're all about getting the next dollar and just doing everything fast. We don't know how to, it's very hard for us to just be still in the midst of the chaos around us. And then another thing is black men holding other black men accountable. This weekend, well, I'm a homebody. I really don't go out, but this weekend I went out, and I don't know if it's just the environment that I went into or if that's just how it is now.
Yeah.
But a man approached me, and he was like, you know, my friend was trying to talk to you. Did he come up to you? And I'm like, no. He's like, yeah, well, I'm just putting in a word. And I think that something is off there, because if a man wants to come and approach you, why can't he come and approach you? Why do you have to send a side?
A word.
Why do you have to send a side person to come and address me, to put in a word for you, to like warm it up? Like, just come to me. And then I said, you know, no, thank you. I'm building my family and blah, blah, blah. He's like, well, are you trying to get married or are you trying to fuck? That's what he told me. And it's like, it's very disappointing to even be approached like that. Like, what is that? Do I have to, is it?
You're, I mean, at a bar or what?
I mean, it was Nigerian Independence Day. So, matter. You know, so I'm like at a club. But I mean, in that type of, in that type of environment, you know, women, you know, can dress, and I guess, in a sexual manner. But then that's a whole nother topic of conversation, because as a woman, I feel like I should be able to dress in the confinement of how I desire, you know, because it's me expressing me and how I am and whatever I feel for the moment. And I don't think that by me dressing in the way that I feel in that particular moment is an invitation.
Are we talking about provocative? If that's the case.
I wasn't perfect.
I'm not saying you were perfect. Are you talking about people? Because usually when people are dressed,
I had
not
on,
provocative, it's not an issue.
I had on jeans and I had on.
But I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about that given case. Because you're talking about women should be able to dress however they so choose.
Mm-hmm.
When no matter what that spectrum is, whether it's conservative, whether it's not so conservative.
He's asking you if you're saying that a woman should be able to dress provocatively and still be respected.
Yeah, it's all about how you carry yourself and your energy.
No, I agree. I agree.
I don't think material has anything to do with how we carry ourselves.
The only thing I will say is this.
I think we put too much emphasis on material.
We do. The only thing I will say is this. There's women that mess it up for you, that have nothing to do with you, that have nothing in line with you. And then there's women that might be caught on the wrong day that stand for the same thing that you stand for.
I disagree.
I think it's the energy. I don't think it's the material.
No.
Wait, hold on. Excuse me.
Okay.
So, when they started killing brothers in hoodies, the conversation went to, well, he shouldn't have a hoodie on. He should think differently about what he has on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But his pictures of us hanging from trees in suits.
Right.
And brothers understand that. I'm not talking about you with what I'm about to say, brother, but I think what you're saying is reflective of a general thing that brothers struggle with. It's sisters who get sexually assaulted in full business suits.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
It's sisters who wear full-on Islamic garb. You can't even see nothing but their eyes, and they get assaulted. And there's this thing about even beginning a conversation about their violation being somehow having something to do with their clothes or a group of women who set a bad example. It's like saying, oh, well, the cop shot you because all these brothers over here that do carry weapons and sell dope wear hoodies, and you was dressing like them. You got on the dress like them uniform, that you're suspicious uniform. But the reality is, what the story that you just told, sister, don't have nothing to do with you. I don't even feel like it's your job.
That's where I was going.
No,
hear me out, sis. I'm saying, I don't think it's your job, because you started talking about men holding other men accountable.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even your job. Like it's people in earshot. If a brother say something to you that's so wild, you should be able to turn and look, and it'd be three other brothers. That's like, yo. But again, no different from how our children be getting beat up by the police and we videotape it while it's happening. Right. When you see them videos, that means, imagine you sitting there.
That's what I was thinking, like, who's recording this?
Sisters be in the club or walking down the street and they getting abused. And his brother sitting there just listening and recording visually that conversation or encouraging that. And we got to challenge that. Like, that can't be cool. To me, and I know you're not saying it's cool, but that's something that we gotta address. That would be my answer to you. Yeah.
Well, that's where I was going. It was a long answer.
I'm sorry, brother. Go ahead. Yeah.
No, it's fine. You already get it, so I'm not.
And you're not talking to me. You're talking to the world.
Right.
No, I said I don't want to be redundant.
Oh, I see.
And I would say this, too. We got to learn how to be kings, and women also got to learn how to be queens. And I look at that as far as, as a king, there's kings. And when we say we're going to treat you as our queen, that means that you know how to be treated like a queen and et cetera. And it's just like it's an energy, it's a respect level. And there's things that we got to learn how to have. You got to learn how to have a relationship with somebody. And I think that there's aspects of that we don't, because I treat you like a queen doesn't mean that I'm your subordinate. Or because you treat me like a queen doesn't make you less than me. And so I think that I could put you on a pedestal and our as a woman, and you could also put me on a pedestal as a man. And I think that sometimes it's a situation where people feel like, oh well, that's simping, or it's tricking, or he's lame. You know what I'm saying? I think that there's certain aspects of relationship in our minds that we don't really even respect, or we don't know how to respect, because we see it as weak, or we see certain things as like, oh well, like there's certain things that we see as strength, and there's certain things that we see as weak. Oh, it could be financial, it could be just aspects of relationships. I don't really have all the examples, but what I would just encourage people is, if you are looking for a relationship, if you are looking for a queen, how you attract that queen is that you treat her like a queen. And if you're a king, then what you'll do is you'll be, if she cannot handle it, if she cannot take that treatment that you're displaying as you being a king and saying, I want this, I want a relationship with you in this type of way, I want to open a door for you, I want to do this or do that, and she's not accepting of that, then just that's not the person for you. I'm a firm believer in what's for you is for you, and everybody isn't going to be for you. You know what I'm saying? And everybody's not going to be able to accept what you're putting out there on the table. And if they don't accept it, then you really probably better off without that person. You know, it'll save you future headaches.
You know what? I actually have something to say. Yeah, I know, right? Just being a father alone, I'm already teaching my son that. Because I guess when we're out, we see a lot of crazy things happening, especially what men be doing to women. And it's kind of sad when my son has to come to me and be like, Daddy, what is he doing? Or Daddy, what's that? What's happening? So I literally have to pull him aside and have that conversation with him. Like, that's something we don't do. And me and my wife, we had to, train him. We're training him now just like how to treat a woman, how to be respectful and everything. And now he's five, but he's like opening doors for women and everything now. So, I think we got started off young too, teaching them how to be respectful and do things right. Because there's a lot of crazy things going on, and he's starting to realize and seeing things what's going on. So you just got to, start treating them right. Kind of, I'm sure you got kids, Charles, you got kids too.
Yeah.
So as a father, that's my question. As a father, how do you explain that to?
Well, I definitely want my son, I want him to see. I mean, it's a trip, honestly. It blows my mind sometimes when I see, because my son is three, and sometimes it blows my mind when I talk to him and he's watching TV and he'll be like, oh, that's his dad, that's his mom, or just cartoon characters, just. It could be two lions, and it'll be a baby lion and a dad and a mom. And in his mind, how the world exists is that there's a mom, there's a dad, and there's the kids. You know what I'm saying? That's how his world is. And so when he doesn't see that, it kind of trips him out. Like, where's his mom? Where's his dad? Or any kind of storyline. And just in general, I just think like that. Hopefully I'm planting those seeds and that he sees like he should be there. He should be the family person. He shouldn't be out there just having kids and not, you know what I'm saying, with with women that you aren't planning on being with. You know what I'm saying? And my wife, and my daughter too. Like I hope that she picks up on those things and she's able to understand, you know, her worth. And and I just think that we are valuable. And one of your keys to success, Ice, was just talking about how, you know, you gotta plan out. Like, one of my goals in life, literally, and I thank God for this. I was like, I don't want to have a baby mama, and I literally wanted to have kids with the person I was married with, and that is a key to success because it's not easy to raise kids when you are a single parent, but it happens. It's life, you know what I'm saying? But at the same time, if you can help it and if you can wrap it up, or if you can use protection or whatever, you got to use contraception in different ways, you know, it's a situation where it will behoove you to choose to be able to choose who you have children with, you know what I'm saying? Because there's so many different variables of how to raise kids and how you want to teach them that, and what you expose them to at a young age is a very important thing. And if you're not there all the time, it's going to be real difficult, you know what I'm saying, to really kind of make sure that, you know, you filter out a lot of stuff.
True. We have a caller. So, caller, give us your name and tell us where you are calling from.
Hi, Jazze Tanner, and I'm calling from Gardena, California.
Thank God.
Shout out to Gardena.
Gardena.
Okay, so this is called Be On Air, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I was trying to get it right because at first when I tuned in, I thought it was called Conscious. And the reason why I thought it was called Conscious because you guys are all talking about things within the Black culture and Conscious, and I just labeled it that. So I love the show. I'm a fan already, and I've been tuning in for almost about an hour and trying to study for my test tomorrow in school. So I don't know how this balance is going.
Hey, shout out to your test.
You're going to do well because you tuned in to us.
What's your test about?
I want to touch on something. I'm still learning the names. I will eventually learn it. There was one young man who said he saw it and didn't feel nothing. I put that in quotations. And leading into that, one young lady touched on survival and how Black culture relies on survival. And I feel like he saw something because he was relying on survival and didn't want to get hurt. Yeah. In quotations, I put, be still in the midst of chaos, but do not ignore the brutality of Black culture. Brutality meaning physical violence or great cruelty. Brutality can have so many different connotations. And in that, that was the quotation I wanted to leave within that conversation. You guys were kind of, you know, transitioning it, and I was writing it down to put it all together. But that's the quote I have for that moment. Be still in the midst of chaos, but do not ignore the brutality of Black culture.
All right.
Girl, you gotta preach.
No, that's amazing.
I'm sorry. Also, my name is Jazze Tanner. I don't know if you guys are aware. I'm running for Miss California USA 2017, okay, representing Gardena. And I just would love you guys to support. And, you know, I would definitely be sharing you guys on my Facebook and things of that sort.
All right. And make sure you send your information to unationradio@gmail.com so that we can share that.
Maybe have you come down sometime.
Yeah, I hope you win.
Okay, is you the letter U Nation?
Yes. You, the letter U, and nationradio@gmail.com.
Okay. Got you.
Thank you.
Good luck. No problem. Good one.
Nice. Beautiful caller. We're going to wrap it up as we talked about the state of Black men in America in different facets. But before we go, we always want to give the chance for our guests to let us know what's going on in your life and your future endeavors.
Cool. My name is Ice Life. That's ISELYFE. And folks can follow me or find me online at icelife.com or at Ice Life on all the major social media platforms. Just stay connected with what I'm doing. Cool.
DJ Ree.
I also want to thank our artist spotlight, Siani, and DJ TNT. Go ahead.
Definitely. SoundCloud.com, Siani. Instagram, Siani, CEIONE. I know it's kind of difficult to think how to spell, but C-E-I-O-N-E. Definitely tune into our radio show on bayliferadio.com every Wednesday and Thursday from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. And yeah, hopefully I'm going to come back soon.
Yeah.
You'll be back. Tangie, Charles, anything?
Go ahead, Tangie.
Well, like I said last week, I am a mother, and so I'm a healer, and I do community work, and that's just me. And I'm just here to be happy.
You can find me at your local barbershop looking for an edge up. I'm always open to talking about love. You know, shout out to love. I love, loves, love. And, you know, I just think that, you know, I'll just say this. If you can make it out of Oakland, you can make it anywhere. So, you know, shout out to Ice Life. I don't know what I was going to say. Yeah, but shout out to Oakland Public Schools. You know what I'm saying? Like, real talk, though, honestly, like, it is amazing to me to just see so many individuals on my timeline that are really doing inspiring things, and a lot of people that have come out of Oakland and Oakland, California, and it's people that I even went to high school with directly. So it just is very inspiring, and I follow Ice Life, and I think that he's a very inspiring individual. I've been to his shows out here in LA, and I just think that it's possible. And if you know, especially when you start at a young age, so I encourage the youth to get out there and just pursue something. And guess what? You know, if you want to be like the next Arnold Schwarzenegger or whatever action movie star, you can do it. Or you might go on that road and you might end up being the next big time producer or director. So, you know, just get on that road and you never know where it's going to lead you.
Hey, about that too. Our spotlight, if you are an up-and-coming artist, independent artist, send your tracks to unationradio@gmail.com or hit me up on Instagram, DJReed2016.
And the lovely Akilah Trinay.
So I want to thank you, Ice Life, for stopping by yet again. And Siani, I appreciate you. I appreciate all the Bay love. You said a lot of stuff that I had to like run back and watch again and take my own notes on, like our caller. But
she was good.
Yeah, because I had a lot of stuff going through my head that I wanted to talk about. Of course, it's never enough time. But that just means that you have to come back again.
Definitely.
You know, and we can definitely keep this going. I did want to say, today I have on my throwback Black Line shirt. Shout out to Black Line. Still love and appreciate you guys. But I just want to wear it specifically because it's October and it's pink and it's breast cancer awareness month, as well as a lot of other awareness things that go on in September. Drug awareness, domestic violence, all types of stuff happens in October. It's very impacted. But for those who are living with breast cancer or any type of cancer or survival of breast cancer, or you know anybody who has passed on from breast cancer, I just send prayers up for you and your family and all your loved ones. Eating healthy and all that stuff, and the things that we really put into our bodies and the things that we do really does affect us, you know, on a wide scale. And then like going to the doctors and getting checkups and all that stuff is extremely important for us in the community, for Black men. You know what I mean? Being not only treating, you know, your nice genital with care, but, you know, your entire body and all of that.
Porcelain.
Your nice genital.
Porcelain.
Sometimes it's better just to say a bad word.
Right.
Yeah. Your nice genital.
So degrading.
Would you say the porcelain?
Yeah, treat like porcelain. Treat your whole body like, like porcelain.
The whole body. The body is a temple, treated like porcelain.
Porcelain.
Yeah. Even though I don't even know what porcelain is, honestly. What name something that's made out of porcelain?
Dolls are made out of porcelain.
Dishes.
Okay, like dishes. Oh, I know the dolls, right? The dolls.
If you drop porcelain, it shatters.
Oh, right. Wow. Okay, yeah. You don't want to break. Can't get that back together.
It's a tear, fragile.
A porcelain penis.
Yes. Hey, yes. Don't break it.
Powerful. Well, Ice Life, I just want to tell you I appreciate you, man.
Right on, brother.
And there's not a lot of people that you can just look at and they don't have to say anything and they can be a great example, and you're one of them.
Right on.
If anybody just watched the way the man moved, then if you just tracked him over time, you would know that he was moving forward and doing positive things. And you are always this man. You are always consistent, and that's cool, you know. And I don't even know how musically in tune you are, but I remember being at your house and we was doing something, and you just like, man, just go play it.
I've never been to his house.
You know, just go play in this register. And after I left your house that day, like, I would practice in that register. And it was like, they call it unlocking your bass. You know what I'm saying? And that was just something way left that I didn't expect to get from you. Aside from just seeing you work and do what you do. So definitely a great example, and I'm proud that you were able to come back, because we talked about you coming back that day, and we talked about us being around for you to come back that day.
Yes,
and you checked up on us in between that time. So again, I just want to say appreciate you.
Right on,
this is Love Sessions, and I just want to tell you, man, it starts with us, it ends with us, and we do have to keep each other accountable, and let's be each other's lifeline.
And say what's up. That was one of my keys to success growing up.
Say what's up.
If you see another black dude and you're a black dude, brother, bring the energy, bring the positive energy with you. And I don't care if the dude is mugging. I've seen so many mugs turn into smiles, just like by me just walking to the room and be like, yo, what up? You know what I'm saying? And it diffuses the situation before there is something. So just say what up to each other.
The best way to diffuse that is just to say brother. Angie Stone from Ice Life, our artist spotlight, DJ Reed, Akila Trine, Tangy, Charles Handy. I am Doncho Detroit. We out of here. Yeah.
My support system, I can't live without him. The best thing since sliced bread is his kiss, his hugs, his lips, his touch. And I just want the whole world to know about my black brother. I love you, and I'll never try to hurt you. I want you to